Hello, everybody. You're listening to Chris Hattingh, researcher at the Free Market Foundation. Thank you very much for joining me on my latest solo podcast. You might be listening to this on Thursday, the 21st of March, when it goes out, or maybe later, depending on when you have electricity. For the international listeners, you might not be aware, South Africa is currently in the grips of another electricity crisis. Eskom, the state-owned electricity supplier and the only one in the country, is facing a number of challenges and issues, and South Africa is right now on stage 4 load shedding, so one isn't sure when one is going to actually have electricity, either at home or at the office or in any number of places. So if you are in South Africa right now and you've got some electricity, I just want to thank you very much for taking some time to listen to my thoughts this week. Now, I thought I would go in depth on Eskom, but I recently read about a study on low business confidence in South Africa, and I thought I would tie the Eskom problem into this low business confidence trend. Now, the study that I'm talking about showed that business confidence in South Africa is at its lowest point in the last 2 years. And this shouldn't really come as a surprise to any of us who read the news and listen to different podcasts on politics and economics. It's quite easy to see the trends and how different policies from the government contribute to low business confidence. To me, there are three things which factor into this low confidence. These are Eskom, the expropriation without compensation trend, and the coming amendment to Section 25 of the Constitution. And then thirdly, the national minimum wage and other onerous business legislation. Now, number one on the national minimum wage. The national minimum wage and any other minimum wages artificially inflate the price of labor, and they make it difficult for both businesses and potential employees to come together to the negotiating table to actually figure out what the employee brings to the table and then what the employer expects from them and can rationally pay them. The national minimum wage is a way of government interfering in business, the way businesses run, and also in the way in which potential employees might try and negotiate contracts. It makes it more difficult for employers and employees to come to agreements in contracts. And unfortunately, it means that more and more people are going to be joining the ranks of the almost 10 million unemployed in South Africa. South Africa is a huge unemployment problem, especially amongst the youth. And I think the national minimum wage is simply another example of the government stepping in with perhaps the noblest of intentions. One doesn't always know a bureaucrat's intentions, but no matter how noble someone's intentions might be, we know that when government interferes in anything in the economy, the consequences are often very dire. The national minimum wage makes it imposes yet another barrier in front of employees, because they might be very, very desperate to find a job, and the business might only be able to pay them less than the minimum wage dictates. But because it is now law, these businesses cannot employ people for less than they can actually afford. So it's going to have disastrous effects, I think. We should not be surprised when we see even more people joining the ranks of the unemployed. And we'll again see these effects in the coming months and years. Perhaps now with the coming elections, this was a way for the government to try and entice more people to vote for them, because they say, you know, see what we've done. We've told businesses they cannot exploit you. But I think it should always be a case of, it should be a case of individual freedom. That should be the measure of anything, of any worth of a policy. If a business and an employee come to a negotiating table and they both agree that this is going to be in the contract, that the business will pay the employee X amount, and it's done voluntarily and freely, that should be the complete and utter private business of both that business and the employee. There's no room for government to interfere and involve itself. If bureaucrats and politicians were really concerned about people, especially the unemployed, they would make it as easy as possible for them to find work. They wouldn't add even more and more barriers to employment. So that was legislation. Now the second one, expropriation without compensation. I think property rights probably underpin all other human rights in a moral and just society. Without property rights, without the ability and protection of the law to own your goods, your house, your wealth, no one can operate with any confidence in a country. There's no security, no reason for you to keep on investing in a country, to live in a country. If property rights are not secure and protected in a constitution, Now, the looming amendment to Section 25 of South Africa's constitution will severely dilute property rights and possibly even remove them. I think once there's any change to the notion, the very concept of property rights, you're already diluting the very concept in both people's minds and in the law, in terms of the law. Government's protection of individual property rights should be absolute. It should not be up for the government to decide who should own property and who should not. We obviously have in South Africa huge racial, historical injustices, but that does not mean that amending Section 25 to take away everyone's property rights is going to solve the problem. Black South Africans were denied their property rights throughout colonialism and apartheid. And then in 1994, with our new constitution, these individual property rights were entrenched, which means that South Africans now can own property. But if we're going to do away with Section 25, or at least dilute it, that just means that the government can come in at any point and take anyone's property that they deem fit. You know, any group which controls government can decide, okay, no, we need to expropriate this farmland, this house, this business, this factory for our purposes. They will not have to justify it. It will simply be accepted. And I think, you know, this sort of change to any constitution will lead us down the path of Venezuela, Zimbabwe, North Korea, all the failed societies in history. Doing away with property rights is simply another way for the government to try and control our lives, just as I mentioned earlier with labor legislation and the national minimum wage. This is government completely overstepping its bounds. Its proper moral mandate is to protect individual rights. It is not its mandate to tell us where we can live, what we can own, these sorts of things. And I think from a business perspective and the low business confidence side, both for local and foreign investors, there's no rational reason for them to invest in South Africa if they're not secure in their property. If they know that at any point in the future, any government bureaucrat can come knocking on their door and tell them, we're expropriating your property, whether it's with compensation or without. I think that's maybe a mistake we make, is we think expropriation with compensation could be morally okay. But I think granting any government the sort of power where it can come in and tell you your property is no longer yours is the definite path to tyranny, especially when you consider how strict the South African government is in terms of firearms legislation. That's also another barrier to government tyranny. But this, to me, this expropriation without compensation issue is probably the biggest existential threat to running a business in South Africa. There's no reason why you would come into South Africa or from here, build a business, invest in it, spend your time, your money, your wealth, your resources, and then at any point it can be seized by the government. So we should not be surprised that business confidence is low. Lastly, I just wanted to mention Eskom and the effect that is having on business. Again, you cannot operate with any certainty in South Africa right now unless you're wealthy enough to buy generators and inverters for both your house and your business. And in general, the trend is only white South Africans can afford that. For many black, poor South Africans, they cannot afford the extra costs that come with Eskom's failures. If only we had different energy suppliers in South Africa, they could compete with each other and hopefully drive down costs and this sort of thing. I think if we had at least two suppliers at the moment, it would already be better than the government-backed monopoly that is Eskom. If Eskom fails, the whole country fails. If we had different competitors, private competitors, they would have to make sure that their service is reliable, otherwise they would lose customers. Right now, people don't have a choice but to receive electricity from Eskom. Eskom can buy electricity from private independent providers, but that electricity is still distributed through the Eskom grid. And the grid is failing, the infrastructure is very old. So whether it's independently produced or not, we need to both privatize the production process as well as the distribution process. Just tying it all together, I think, you know, just to sort of sum up the three factors of low business confidence: labor legislation, expropriation without compensation, and Eskom. We'll continue to see a low business confidence trend in South Africa. The policies adopted by government and enacted by government are not pro individual freedom or pro business freedom. They're all pro government. They're pro increasing the size and scope of government, increasing the chunk of the economy which the government takes every year. There's nothing in these policies which encourage economic growth. And for long as these policies follow the trend of bigger government, we're going to see low business confidence. We're not fostering a society which celebrates business, entrepreneurship, growth, individual freedom, and individual responsibility. We're currently pursuing the path of collectivism, of big government, of government spending, of large government programs and plans. And for as long as this continues, unfortunately, we're going to see high unemployment, less investment, and lower business confidence. All right. Thank you, listeners, for joining me this week. I just wanted to thank you all very much for the great responses I received last week to my podcast and the great listener numbers. I hope that you enjoy this week's episode. Please leave your comments below. Let me know what you think is impacting on the low business confidence we're seeing in South Africa. And let me know what you think about politics and economics and the whole Eskom situation in the country at the moment. I'll talk to you again next week. Goodbye.